This is a story of revenge and getting back at people who have wronged you. A tale of indignation, annoyance, and exploitation. I used to work at Nickelodeon for a while as an early job to get on my feet in order to move out of my parents' house. I was always fascinated by the concept of animation and all the cool and funny things you can do with it. I worked very hard towards that dream to make it a reality. My parents, thankfully, were extremely supportive of the idea and always looked to help me where they could. Eventually, after years of searching, Nickelodeon themselves were hiring for animators. The pay was pretty standard and the hours weren't too obnoxious, so I decided to go for it. I loved Nickelodeon ever since I was a little kid, Rocko's Modern Life in particular. I have had vivid daydreams about the day when my ideas would get picked up by a higher executive at any animation studio. So, the mere thought of Nickelodeon themselves offering to hire me was incomprehensible. Wow. After a few days of filling things out properly and figuring out where the building was, I was off to that building that would help me hone my skills. I arrived there after 45 impatient minutes, and when I pulled up, not gonna lie, I was a little disappointed. The building looked very grubby and barely resembled any kind of Nickelodeon building I had thought of before. The only way I could tell that the place was the right one was because of the signature Nickelodeon slime on the walls and the massive sign which hung above. I learned not to judge a book by its cover as a child, however, I couldn't exactly forget about my disappointment either. So, grinning and bearing it, I tried inside the facility. When I entered, I saw that nobody looked like they were enjoying their jobs. And when I mean nobody, I really mean nobody. They all looked like their family had forgotten about their birthdays. Constant gloomy and sad expressions on their face. Like, dude. But I'm getting off topic, so let's discuss what the story is really about. Revenge. Not revenge of a singular entity, but the revenge of multiple people seeking a goal to mess with Nickelodeon. The year was 2004, and the SpongeBob movie had just wrapped up in its entirety. The entire staff was completely and absolutely diminished. It looked like as if all joy had completely vanished in their lives. The higher executives wanted this movie out at an extremely specific and not light date, giving us not much time around the clock to produce it. We also learned of the news that Steven Hillenburg had decided to depart from the show, believing that SpongeBob had pretty much run its course. I completely agreed with his viewpoint. I mean, look at the show Rugrats, for instance. That show has been beyond milked to death at this point. Every single time I see a damn Rugrats plush, I just want to burn it! Never mind. It looked like as if SpongeBob was going to be the newest money cow for the company to milk profits from. And now, looking at it many years later, it unfortunately indeed became the money cow for Nick. Oh boy. Naturally, there was some hostility and dislike amongst the staff members about how much the higher-ups were pressuring and forcing us to produce mediocre and bland episodes on a constant loop with very little breaks or inspiration. Our pay remained consistently the same, considering how much time we were now working. It seemed as if we were being ripped off. I was in this camp too, being very saddened and annoyed that one of my favorite companies, a media giant I used to worship as a child, being a complete facade. It was only a matter of time before we inevitably snapped, not like a total maniac, but we snapped in anger. Then, one of us came up with a plan to finally exact revenge on this disgusting, abusive company for good. One higher executive in particular, we'd call him Gerald, was always a massive fan of Mr. Krabs. Guess he saw a splitting image of himself within the character. So, in a way to get back at him in particular, we decided to craft a Mr. Krabs-oriented episode. The title was certainly a tough choice, as we threw around a ton of options before we finally settled on Karma Krabs. Now, no matter how crafty or tech-savvy we were, there was no chance of us convincing the original voice actors like Tom Kenny to voice act in our little project. Our solution was to steal segments of other episodes and word sync them up with our script. Thankfully, one of the guys tinkered with the audio in his spare time. It was not perfect due to the limited number of resources we had, but, you know, it looked believable enough. I, myself, never took part in the actual animation or the voice acting. I was more the lookout and scout of the group, collecting information and picking up signs so too if the executives suspected something was weary. After slaving away at the project for a little over a year, finally, it was completed. This is the final product. The writers involved were not best and often used slanderization in order to cover up some of their own flaws. The episode would begin with the pirate portrait singing the iconic theme song of SpongeBob SquarePants, with the titular Sponge popping out to play his nose like a flute. Sorry about that. The episode would then cut to show the title card. A zebra-colored font appeared reading Karma Krabs. It showed what looked like a prison cell with rusting iron bars. Dollar bills covered the rest of the title card, filling the blanks of which where the jail cell was not. A photo of Pearl and Mr. Krabs was sitting on the bed of the jail cell. However, Mr. Krabs was crossed out. The title lingered before cutting into the actual show. It cut over to the Krusty Krab restaurant on a seemingly normal day. The place was completely stuffed with hungry customers, as usual, barking requests at the cash register. Sitting within the confines of the boat, Squidward, the lovable but grumpy octopus, Squidward was sloppily writing down the orders for the crowd and hung them up over the hole which led to the kitchen.
SpongeBob, I need 2 Krabby Double Deluxes, a side of Krabby Pie, and a cup soda,
Squidward said in his usual nasally voice.
Okie dokie, Squidward. 2 Krabby Double Deluxes, a side of Krabby Fries, and a kelp soda coming up,
SpongeBob announced with his glee as he eagerly extended his hands and grabbed the notes. It then cut to show SpongeBob working on making the delectable Krabby Patties. He flipped them high throughout the air, whistling a tune to himself. The sponge then expertly landed them onto a set of buns, while tossing the usual ketchup, mustard, lettuce, cheese, and tomatoes with an onion. Happy with his work, like always, SpongeBob dinged the bell twice and handed the food to Squidward.
Sir, I paid with a $10 note. I should have, like, $3 in change back.
The fish began while he accepted the food. Squidward rolled his eyes and reached into the cash register. The second he did this, the dramatic audio cue would play. Mr. Krabs then busted through the door while looking furious.
Mr. Squidward, what is the meaning of this? We don't open the cash register.
Mr. Krabs shouted while the furious look still lingered on his face. The crustacean was recently being forced to pay more taxes than usual after it was discovered that he's been avoiding them for a while. However, they do not know the full extent of Mr. Krabs' greed.
Mr. Krabs, he paid with a $10 note. He needs $3 in change.
Squidward responded while being slightly unnerved by his boss's sudden outburst, like any normal human being.
I don't care about that. In fact,
Mr. Krabs retorted while running to the front of the restaurant. as he retrieved a chalkboard and began writing something in the window. It said,
"No change."
Everyone in the restaurant cringed at the sound of the chalk being scribbled on.
Mr. Krabs, what has gotten into you? You're acting more like a cheapskate than usual.
Squidward retorted while being slightly annoyed.
I have to pay the bills and taxes, Mr. Squidward. Every single penny matters. In fact, due to your behavior, I'm docking your pay by $25.
The greedy crab announced as he gave Squidward an annoyed look. The octopus looked absolutely floored at what his boss announced to him. The fish who was waiting for his change stood impatiently.
"Hey, when am I going to get my change back?" he asked Mr. Krabs.
"You're not getting a penny from me, even if I get thrown into Davy Jones's locker!"
Mr. Krabs said rudely. Before the fish could respond, Mr. Krabs cartoonishly picked him up and tossed him out of the building. Squidward grunted and made noises of annoyance before he retreated away from Mr. Krabs and exited the building to take a break. SpongeBob seemed to notice there was something wrong with both Mr. Krabs and Squidward. He then proceeded to follow Squidward out of the Krusty Krab and went to talk to him.
"Squidward, is it just me, or is Mr. Krabs acting nastier than usual?"
SpongeBob asked, trying to strike a conversation with the octopus.
"For once, I actually have to agree with you, SpongeBob,"
Squidward responded. Mr. Krabs has always been a cheapskate, but not one that was nasty. The episode then cut back to show Mr. Krabs sighing with annoyance after the altercations with the fish from earlier. Some mysterious music was playing in the background, as if to indicate something sketchy was going on. A flashback suddenly came forth, showing Mr. Krabs cheerfully checking his personal vault full of his own valuables. Then all of a sudden, a loud kaboom shook the entire restaurant. Mr. Krabs immediately darted to the front of the restaurant and caught sight of what was happening. Plankton had planted a bomb onto one of the windows in the Krusty Krab. A giant hole and a pile of debris was the only thing that remained of the wall. Mr. Krab charged forward to confront Plankton. Oddly, his rival did not do anything to slow or stop his pursuit.
"Plankton, this has got to be the worst of your plans to steal me formula. You didn't even try to go forward into the restaurant,"
Mr. Krabs said while giggling at Plankton.
"You know what, Krabs? After all these years, I have begun to realize how much of a truly awful person you are," Plankton begun.
This caused Mr. Krabs, the foolish crab that he is, to stand still awkwardly for a moment. A look of genuine confusion was on his face.
"And? It's about time the public knew,"
Plankton announced. He then retrieved a hidden needle and stuck it to the back of Mr. Krabs. He injected the yellow liquid into the crustacean system. Mr. Krabs yelped slightly in pain. He then proceeded to toss Plankton out of the hole he had created in the wall. This time, instead of comedically threatening Krabs as he usually did, he instead flew with a big grin on his face.
"The plan went perfect, my dear computer wife. You actually came up with a good plan for once,"
Plankton announced as he was caught in midair by Karen, his computer wife.
"Now all we have to do is lay low and let this happen. Don't go messing this up like you always do, okay?"
Karen said nonchalantly.
"Yes, soon the world will finally see the truth about crabs, and the formula will be rightfully mine.
Plankton said with his signature evil grin. It then cut back to Mr. Krabs, who was rummaging around his office for something. He retrieved a bottle which contained the Krabby Patty's secret formula itself. He then proceeded to hide it within his safe and placed the lock over it to seal it shut. Mr. Krabs was clearly paranoid and distrustful as his eyes darted around the room, looking for a threat, but seemingly finding none. It cut back to Squidward and SpongeBob still outside.
"I got it," It must be Plankton's work, Squidward. He always tries to steal the Krabby Patty secret formula. Maybe he did something with it to Mr. Krabs.
SpongeBob said.
Alright. Look, I'm only trying to help you here because Mr. Krabs is more light abusive right now. Don't think that this makes us best friends or anything, okay?
Squidward said before SpongeBob got any ideas.
Plankton, what have you done to Mr. Krabs?
SpongeBob shouted as he kicked open the door to the chum bucket. Squidward followed in close behind.
I have no idea what you're talking about, SpongeBob.
Plankton responded nonchalantly.
Cut the lies, Plankton. I know you did something to Mr. Krabs, and I want it done. Brrrr,
Squidward said angrily. Plankton remained calm despite Squidward's aggressive accusations. He proceeded to hop off Karen and made his way to a computer screen.
You two seriously think Mr. Krabs is a worthwhile person? SpongeBob, he pays you practically nothing despite all the hard work you put in for him. Squidward, he constantly annoys you and underpays you just as much as SpongeBob.
Plankton had begun.
No, Mr. Krabs is a good guy. You're the one who made him nasty.
SpongeBob responded with slight hesitancy in his voice.
I merely accelerated who he truly is, SpongeBob. The stuff he doesn't tell you about.
Plankton continued. It then cut to Karen playing something on the massive monitor screen. Squidward and SpongeBob pulled out a seat and both sat down watching the screen. The screen cut to a video feed that was taken a few months ago. The static crackled for a moment until finally the feed loaded. It showcased Mr. Krabs and Pearl getting into an altercation about how Mr. Krabs never pays for anything for her and how he put absolutely no effort into getting her anything of substantial value. The argument got heated pretty quickly, and there were even some bleep swear words. Bleep with the sound effects from Sailor Mouth, of course. Until the inevitable happened. Mr. Krabs, in a fit of blind anger, smacked Pearl viciously across the face with one of his claws. This knocked her on her butt, and a red mark was the only thing that remained from her attack. She began sobbing hysterically as he attempted to run away from the house, only to be intercepted by the angry crab. Mr. Krabs had retrieved a butcher's knife and held it to Pearl's throat, threateningly.
If you ever breathe a word of this to anyone, I will put you in the ground, do you hear me?
Mr. Krabs bellowed at the top of his lungs. Pearl nodded quickly and ran out of the house. This was around the only time that Pearl stopped visiting the crusty crab. Feed faded out into the statics once more. It cuts back to showcase another video that was taken more recently. Said video displayed Mr. Krabs stealing money directly from his mother's purse. A sickeningly wide grin was present on his face as he robbed his own flesh and blood clean of their hard-earned wealth. Plankton retrieved the remote and fast-forwarded to the footage to show Mr. Krabs counting the money within his office. It was a massive well over six figures. Mr. Krabs began sobbing to himself as he retrieved two $100 bills and two $50 bills and stuffed them within two envelopes. $150 for both SpongeBob and Miss Squidward. Mr. Krabs was beyond wealthy. Yet he neglected and downright abused his daughter, robbed his own mother blind, and constantly extorted and took advantage of SpongeBob's gullibility. That was seemingly the final feed as the TV stopped humming and the picture finally disappeared. Squidward and SpongeBob were beyond furious. I had never seen SpongeBob look this angry. Ever. Not even when Squidward was unemployed and freeloading off SpongeBob.
Oh, Squidward, oh my god, Squidward looked far worse. His bulbous head had a noticeable, pulsating vein. His entire face was as red as a strawberry, and his eyes cartoonishly became volcanoes. I know you're going to think that I tamper with the footage, SpongeBob, but I promise you and Squidward, I have not messed with this, Plankton stated. But I had a good reason to further along his descent into absolute evilness, so you and the other people could stop being manipulated by him. I promise you, if you help me give Mr. Crab some justice, I will hire both of you to work at the Chum Bucket. His secret formula will be confiscated, and I can easily get it back. Not to mention, I will pay you both, both of you, a fair and equal amount, with breaks included.
Plankton continued.
I will not extort any customers or do anything illegal. I just want to grab off the streets.
SpongeBob never thought for a moment in his life that Plankton was secretly the victim of this entire ordeal. But with this footage and other pieces of evidence to back it up, there was no point defending Mr. Krabs anymore.
Alright, Plankton. You have a deal.
SpongeBob and Squidward said as they reached down and shook hands with Plankton. The French narrator then appeared with the title card saying,
3 days later.
Mr. Krabs was in his office, counting his dollar bills, when he received a knock on his door. Upon opening said door, he was tackled to the ground by both SpongeBob and Squidward. His claws were bound and tied behind him as the cop music began to play. 3 police fish entered the building and began cuffing Mr. Krabs.
What is going on? I'm here. I'm a service.
Mr. Krabs said with nervousness. Eugene Krabs, we have had our eyes on you for the longest time. We have received an anonymous tip from someone about your crimes. The first cop fish had begun. Now we are taking you to court, and you will face justice for the abuse, neglect, and greed you have been doing for the past few years. The second fish said in a serious tone. Mr. Krabs began crying as he was taken away by the cop fishes. The bubble splash screen appeared, which transitioned into the court. The jury of the court consisted of a few background fish, but also some familiar faces, notably Mr. and Mrs. Puff, Sandy, Squilliam, Larry the Lobster, the fish from earlier of which Mr. Krabs had tossed out, and lastly, Patrick. Oddly was present. It was a while since I have seen the episode. I have no longer have access to it as of writing this, so I will attempt to explain what happened. SpongeBob and Squidward were up first and begun testifying their case against Mr. Krabs. It showed various episodes through a flashback to complement the scene. Notable examples include Graveyard Shift, where SpongeBob and Squidward were forced to work 24 hours, Born Again Krabs, where Mr. Krabs infamously sells SpongeBob's soul for 62 cents, and a bunch more. SpongeBob inevitably broke down into tears after recounting all the episodes and how much Mr. Krabs was taking advantage of his hard work and never fully compensating him. The poor Sponge actually yelled at Mr. Krabs and completely and utterly shattered his facade of being a good person. Everyone in the jury and in the general crowd had mixtures of anger and horrified expression on their faces. Eventually, it was Squidward's turn to call Mr. Krabs out for being such a horrible, horrible boss. Constantly extorting them, both him and SpongeBob, overworking the both of them with zero rewards and benefits. How he cared about a penny more than the safety of his own staff members. Not to mention that Mr. Krabs stole money from his own mother. She was a retired crab living a comfortable life. She always treated and loved Eugene, but due to his money-hungry attitude consuming him so much, he took advantage of that kindness and robbed her. Mr. Krabs was called to the front and begun to testify against the claims that Squidward and SpongeBob made. Most of the claims and defenses that the crustacean brought forward were either complete bogus, manipulated truths, or sob stories for the sake of buying sympathy. Kind of pathetic in the long run. One by one, all the individuals in the room began talking amongst themselves about the whole ordeal. The camera panned around, showing the many sea creatures' expressions and mannerisms as they discussed their opinions. The jury
during this time, had retreated back to his own private room to talk. Mrs. Krabs was close to tears after she heard her own son lie through his teeth. And SpongeBob left his own seat and went over to comfort the elderly crab. Finally, after what seemed like an eternity, the jury had exited the room and had come to a definite conclusion.
Your Honor, me and the jury have reached a conclusion. We find Eugene H. Krabs guilty on all accords.
One of the fish announced, while the other fish nodded their heads agreeingly. The judge, who was a lobster like Larry, agreed with the jury, but in a twist.
Eugene Krabs, we will not send you to prison. That would be too simple of a punishment. You will instead take all of your money, remove your daughter from your care, while providing her with a restraining order against you. Your Krabby Patty secret formula will go to auction and the highest bidder will win the recipe. You will serve community service for the rest of your entire life, and you will never be allowed to touch a single piece of money ever again.
The judge decided. Mr. Krabs began breaking down and sobbing like a complete and utter crybaby. He begged and pleaded with SpongeBob and Squidward to tell the judge and jury that he was innocent, but his plea fell on deaf ears. Mr. Krabs had received a visit from the almighty force known as Karma. A title card flashed on the screen with the narrator saying,
1 year later.
The episode then cut to a final part, which showed the Chum Bucket bustling with customers. The rancid, unappealing exterior was modified and updated. The place was renamed to the Burger Bucket, and sold bucket burgers for more reasonable prices than the Krusty Krab. SpongeBob was smiling his happy smile, working to feed the hungry crowd of customers. Squidward, even though looking a little bored working at the cash register, he did not look depressed at least. Plankton himself was smiling with glee and happily counting the money he had earned legitimately. Karen was proud of her husband's accomplishments at finally getting the formula and using it to become a better person than Mr. Krabs. As for Mr. Krabs himself, well, he was never heard from ever again. Some say the crab fled the city. Others said he died on the streets. But no one truly ever knew what happened to Eugene Krabs. The episode faded and the credits rolled. You may wonder, with such precautions taken, how many hours we slaved away and the amount of help we had, how did this episode not air? Well, it all came down to stress. Staff were inevitably caught fabricating this episode when one of our group members cracked under the stress of going against the company. We were all fired on the spot and blacklisted from Nickelodeon. I decided to share the story before it got completely faded off of my memory. This episode is a perfect example of why you should never let greed get to your head. It corrupts you, warps you, and destroys any kind of stable life you have. That's unfortunately exactly what happened to Mr. Krabs. And if you're not careful, the very same situation could happen to you. Some may not believe in karma. Well, I certainly do not. But after this tale, I advise you all to be good people. Because you never know when even you yourself could end up being the next Karma Krab. And so we've reached the end of Karma Krab, a SpongeBob Lost episode creepypasta by none other than the dark author himself. By the way, go subscribe to his channel. He is close to 1,000 subs. Let's make him reach, I don't know, friggin' 10K by the end of this year. But still. Oh, by the way, this is also my very first creepypasta review, so just let me know what I can do to improve.
and also what I can do to improve on my creepy pasta reading. But anyway, let's get on to my thoughts on the story. And yeah, it's very great. I mean, it's very good. And it's not like the greatest creepy pasta ever, but it's far away from being the worst. Now, the concept of this story, where Mr. Krabs finally gets caught for all the horrible things he does, I like the concept. Like, I want this to be an episode for so, so long. Like, you can't even imagine how long I wanted this to be an episode. Like Mr. Krabs is a really, really terrible person, especially in the after the movie, the first movie. Furthering Plankton's insanity and paranoia by dressing up as his own daughter just in like one course meal, which, oh god, that's unpleasant. Like, Mr. Krabs is a total psychopath, like, absolutely. I mean, he literally sold SpongeBob's soul for 62 cents. And that was not even like post movie SpongeBob. That was like pre movie SpongeBob. And even though that episode and the bit was pretty enjoyable and funny, it makes you question if Mr. Krabs should even have the right to even own a multi-million-dollar restaurant. And yeah, this episode was really, really satisfying to read. So yeah, that's one thing. And the story is very nice. However, I do believe it works more as a fan fiction than a creepypasta, because aside from that one moment where with Mr. Krabs and Pearl, which I'll get to later, it doesn't really feel like a creepy SpongeBob episode or disturbing at all, aside from that one moment. This feels like an actual episode, like you see on television. I'm sorry if I'm like fumbling over my words. This is totally unscripted, so I'm sorry about that. And what else? Yeah. However, there are some problems. Mainly, there are some words, like some grammatical errors. They kind of sound like the most boring English teacher when I say that, but like, yeah, there are some words that need to be capitalized. Like, sometimes SpongeBob is lowercase, and then other times it's capitalized. There are some grammatical inconsistencies, if I do say so myself. But other than that, I think the sentence structuring is nice. But the grammar needs to be worked on. And then again, this was only meant to be listened to, not read, you live, you learn, I guess. Now comes the creepy factor. The creepy factor when the part where like Mr. Krabs like hits Pearl and like threatens her to basically kill her, that was extremely disturbing. Like, really, really disturbing. Like, when the creepy factor comes, it's really effective. Like, I was legit scared of Krabs. Like, I mean, you don't want to see him wake up on the wrong side of the bed, am I right? So, And also there are some little bit of character inconsistencies, but which I get because as the writer previously stated, the writers in the story who made the episode use flanderization to cover up some of their flaws, I guess. So I guess the inconsistencies is fine, but what I'm talking about is like Plankton like becoming good after like stealing the Krabby Patty formula, and I to a certain extent I actually want Plankton to be good in life, would want to succeed in life. But in the SpongeBob movie, he like
The same thing kind of happened with King Neptune pretty much accusing Mr. Krabs for doing something, like calling him out for his for all the horrible things he did. I mean just one horrible thing, like stealing the crown. And with SpongeBob accusing Mr. Krabs of not giving him the managerial promotion because Mr. Krabs thinks he's a kid, something, and then he gets frozen, and then Plankton sells. Plankton steals the formula, and then he becomes like some dictator and makes everybody slaves. And that's kind of inconsistent. But dude, then again, most of these most SpongeBob episodes aren't even. What is that? Damn, I forgot. They don't have any continuity, so who am I to judge? So, what would I do to personally make this story better is, like, fix the grammatical inconsistencies and add more onto the creepy factor. Not like blood and guts gore. That's not what I think. Atmosphere is what makes a good creepypasta. That's what I think. And, all in all, my final thoughts on this entire creepypasta, the concept, I'd give a 10 out of 10. Story, I'd give a, I give it a 9 out of 10. The grammar, I'd give, like, maybe an 8 out of 10, because because even though there are some grammatical errors, at least the story is understandable, unlike other bad Lost episode creepypastas. But I'm not saying this creepypasta is bad, it's actually very, very nice. But the creepy factor, I'd have to give it like a 5 out of 10. But those 5 points are only for that one moment alone, which is really, really effectively creepy and disturbing. So, my final thoughts on this entire creepy pasta. I would give it a solid, 10 plus 19 plus, no, 10 plus 9 plus 8 plus 5, give me a moment, 8 out of 10, solid 8 out of 10, very nice creepypasta, very good concept, would need a little bit more creepiness for my taste, and it needs to work on the grammar, you did nice, Gucci, you did, totally tubular, I'm sorry, please don't take my opinions to heart or anything like that, because this is all opinionated. I'm not some creepypasta critic expert or whatever the hell you like to call it. And, this is all opinionated, and whatever you like, you like, and whatever you hate, you hate. But please don't send me death threats. Anyways, leave your thoughts on the comments below on, what are your thoughts on the story? If you like it or hate it, I don't know. And, I guess, I'll be ending the video right here. Thanks for watching, and, by the way, I could be switching up my content. I haven't done these types of videos. I think I've done these types of videos, but I've never done a creepypasta review, so... I'm probably gonna make more, like, of these types of videos and less, meme edits. I will make, like, meme-oriented videos, obviously, whenever I'm gonna make a meme, I'll probably put some effort into it instead of, like, getting, like, a video and then just removing an audio where I want another audio to be in, that stuff. That's pretty lazy, so. And, probably switching up my content. And I'm making this review too long. I guess I'll be ending it here. Later, broskies, and remember,
Where there's smoke, they pinch back. Dab. All right, bye.